Spirit to prove, make this real for you. As the Father has a relationship with the one we call the Logos, the Scriptures have called him that, and he called him Jesus Christ, the Son of God, called him the Logos so that we would comprehend how the Father comprehends, that we would comprehend how the Father comprehends the Son. Much of the time we're trying to comprehend the Son, we're trying to, on our linear line here, trying to build a relationship with him and get him involved in our lives. The Holy Spirit not only wants to reveal Christ to you, but wants to reveal the Christ of the Father's heart. Know him as the Father knows him is liberating. And probably the least liberating. It is because you don't have to see you at all. You don't have to comprehend you at all to understand that you're included. It's called identification. It's big. I wrote it down. We must see ourselves in without really seeing us. This is hard because we're always looking it up. When the heart turns from us, when it turns to the Lord, the veil is rent. But until that time, we are still outside of the very presence and reality of God, working and carrying on all the things that we've been assigned to faithfully, thinking that we're, you know, really attained because people outside of the outer court are out there sinning and doing whatever, but at least we're busy about the things. God. But we have not yet entered in. Isn't that amazing? We haven't truly entered in yet. And so the whole thing is that veil be rent. And then I made that said, we must see ourselves in without really seeing us. If you can learn that you're included there, that the heart of the Father never changes on any linear point, no linear point can change this. You're going to change your position there. The only thing that can change your position there is that you disconnect and you do that consistently for a long period of time. And I believe you eventually choose another form of gaining what only can be gained through the cross, through Christ. Through works, through, or just ignoring what's going on, I don't care. But to see yourself there without seeing you, that's a real key. We are not there because we existed. See, that's hard for us to think in terms of what is true of us apart from our existence. We are not there because we existed as a personality. Your personality has absolutely nothing to do with it. I mean, it has nothing to do. It doesn't make you better or worse. It doesn't do anything. It's not a factor. You know, so there's no room for pride or there's no room for self-pity. Which are both just different aspects of the flesh. Here's the flesh. One half is full of pride, the other half is self-pity. You know, it's flesh. One's just down flesh, the other's up flesh. We go, ooh, you're better than I am. You're a little better than you are. Flesh is flesh. You know, I love the Lord Jesus. I love how he talked because he knew this. You know, now it's obvious. It's evident. Because he goes, he makes things flesh. That which is flesh is flesh. I mean, that is just so, that just cuts it right to the quick. Everything is flesh is flesh. Don't try to make it any more what it is. Don't call pride flesh better than self-pity flesh. Call it all flesh and say, if it's not flesh, the only thing left is Christ. Because he's not flesh. And so I can identify as Christ. It just makes life so easy. We're not there because we existed as a personality or a creature of manifestation. And that's really all you are. You are a creature of manifestation. And everything that is anything to you is happening on this platform. The good things, the bad things. There's nothing more than whatever on this timeline. So we see that the knowledge of good and evil, it shows you good things. It shows you bad things. And that never was the tree God wanted you to eat of in the first place. He wanted you to partake of life. You can only do that in the lower tree called the country. But that's eating. This is called eating of the tree of life. Because Jesus is the life. He said, eat my flesh, drink my blood. And if you eat an apple, it becomes one with you. Well, the neat thing is, and it says this, I love this scripture, it's so cool, because really and truly, if you took a graft and you took the, the way you do grafting, a lot of people don't understand this, but the way you actually do grafting is that if you have a bad tree, you take a good branch and plug it into that bad tree, and it brings forth good fruit. I mean, really, that's what it is. The contrary to nature, you were taken out of bad and put it into good. It says that. And this is the tree of life. Contrary to nature, we have been taken out of the bad and we're placed in here. And so, like, if you eat something, it becomes one with you. Well, to eat Jesus' flesh and drink his blood is to become one with him, contrary to nature. It's to become one with him. To identify with him, wrapped up in flesh and blood, every aspect. You don't understand yourself apart from being united with Christ. There is no understanding. I mean, now I know that, you know, if you have certain pressure and all this, that's not what I'm talking about. But I'm talking about the basic whatever you are. Never unplugs. Never. Now, you know, I mean, we're still growing in that, and Mallory's making the point that we will yet be growing in that. But I mean, there is a basic plugging in that says, man, I cannot, will not. I mean, if this is the truth, I cannot leave the truth. Well, I don't want to leave the truth. And when I find myself speaking, see, I mean, it's not just living. Speaking, living, acting, attitudes, contrary to the truth, it is an abomination to me. It is not acceptable. It is not passe. It is not just, you know, something you just get over and forgive. It is my enemy. This is one who loves the Lord. You know, the second love the Lord. You know. And, you know, here's where the conflict comes. The conflict is between flesh and spirit. And so our flesh likes something, you know, for the box here representing whatever. My flesh likes it. Yeah, sure it does. Of course it does. It's flesh. It likes the things of the world into the flesh. Okay? And so, and because we, and here's what we do, we call this facing the truth. Well, I'd be lying if I said I didn't like that. I'm a sinner. Yucky, and I don't like it. Everybody's like it. I walk all over everybody's like it. I'd hate it, but I keep liking it. And that's somebody who's never seen that they're in union with Christ. They've never seen that they never divided their spirit from their soul. They never divided that. And so they identify with their flesh. And so that makes them say, okay, that boy's out. Anything. Flesh is self-conscious. Spirit is God-conscious. And we say, because I like this, especially when you get on a green slide, you ever been on a slide that's real slippery or whatever, you end up sliding down. You try to fight it. There you go. Especially when you're in the middle of it, the devil talks about us, or your flesh talks about us, and says, see, you really like this, and there ain't no hole in your body. Let me tell you, we let that God. I'm never going to convince my flesh not to like it. The first step is to at least agree with God. Christ is my life, and his life manifests a certain way, and he wants people, I would just say, oh, meditate on Christ in your life for too long, then you take practical steps. You go over there and you're blessed. You say, well, how can I do that? I don't feel it. Don't go by feelings. Go by life. He is your life. He's your life at that moment. And I see people continually waiting for someday when Jesus does so-and-so. And he's going, he's never going to be any more than your life than he is right now. And so you go, you know, I mean, there's no question in this situation. It's not spooky. It's not, oh, I need God to intervene. It's, I know what Christ is. Christ is my life. I believe that. Here comes Jesus. And many times in the blessing, I feel that soul just disappear. In the rooting with the Lord, it's like opening up a channel. Whew. But if I'm sitting there waiting for him to go, whew, you know what I mean? That's what I'm over there. Well, I'm mad, but come on, Lord. That's what we're doing. We're waiting. And that's something linear down here. That's not how that comes in here. I'm in him. He's in me. This is the Son of Israel. Here it comes. Look out. Here comes Jesus. That's the soul. Here it comes. That's the kingdom come. You know, I mean, was if I go with my soul, am I still saved? Yeah, we're not talking about the Savior, we're talking about the kingdom. He is not king if he ain't governed. You know? So, you know, a lot of people will go, no, Lord, no. We're not dealing with it. We're dealing with life. We're trying to get you in a relationship with the Father through the Son. But a lot of people want to, they like the feeling of unleashing on somebody. Or, you know what I mean? They like to, you know, go with the flesh. It feeds their flesh. You know what I mean? And if you begin to really see this from God's viewpoint, you don't like the flesh. Not their flesh. I don't even know how to put this because it's almost like, well, I'll say it. Everybody can talk and say, I'm going to be a son of God, but I'm the only one that knows for sure I am. But I don't expect anybody else to really be sincere or follow through. I don't expect it ever. And if it ever happens, I rejoice. But if it doesn't, I didn't expect it anyway. I'll tell you what I do is I expect it right here. The flesh I'm concerned with is not there. You know that I've been up with a lot of flesh. I have for a long time. But that doesn't concern me. Now when I start as a shepherd, it starts concerning God. And I think that's not me. It's just going, you know, your flesh, you know, going around trying to shift that up my else's flesh. You know, I ain't got no business talking. I ain't got no business leading. I ain't got no business doing anything until I can see some way. I'm not just here, but knowing this bond, this union is working, where I can know that Christ is, that this is the truth. If this ain't the truth, it don't work. Then what's the point? You know, I mean, I don't want to. If it's a trick, it works. It's working in me. And it's going to continue to work. And I have hope. Then you don't get discouraged. I mean, if I can have hope and joy looking at me, you got it, man. place that we are is not heaven. The place that, and we already are, all that we can ever hope to be, if we will but abide there, we will manifest what was true. But we already are there. And you didn't do anything to get there. You know, you just believed the truth before that God had died for you. Jesus died for you. I feel like we actually centered a lot on verse 12. We jumped to verse 13 a long time and then went back to 12. And I just felt like the Lord was telling me we should move on into verse 14. So I want to read it because this is a next step. The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld His glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. This is the next phase. The first phase is the seed phase. It is the core, it is the beginning. That is that which is between the Father and the Logos. The second phase is the creation of all things so that something apart from this, this was in the beginning, this was before anything. And after all the linear is gone, this will be. But there had to be something to be brought into that, and that's where creation comes from. But man fell, and so Jesus, this Logos, not the Son of God, not the Christ or the Messiah, the Word was made flesh. The total thought, the complete thought and concept of God was made flesh and dwelt among us. Okay? Not Jesus. God is trying to awaken us to this, but He couldn't get us up here, so He came down here. With the fall of great gulf that sits between the two, where we could never, of our own ability, come to this reality. So He sent His Son, the Word, was made flesh, and dwelt among us. Along that line, we were talking about the flesh, the spirit, and how we do, you remember this many times, we basically don't believe. That's just the leader commandment. Having confessed and believed it, move with all that we know how to make it great with it. You know, and then you can take steps, and you end up somewhere after a while. You know? You do. You know, I was like this rocker. You know, we soon will have it totally paid off. We don't dig anything along the way. It's just like we can, we were faithful. And everything works out if you're just faithful and you continue forward. But if you just hear the truth, you become a forgetful hearer and you don't care, you don't move. Or you say you care, you say you're a sincere person, but you spend your input is from the world or the devil or the flesh, and that's what you're trying basically to be, then that's what you're going to get the harvest from. I mean, whatever you put in your ground, that's what you're going to get back. So, I put the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, or was manifested. The Word was made flesh and manifested. Not through us, but to us. The Word, in this case, was not manifested to us, I mean through us, but to us. And then I put, we want it manifested where we can touch it. Before we will believe it. But this always works. This always works.
This is just one more example of how the Father showed to us linearly what was already true by the Word and the flesh. It always was the Word. In the beginning, the Word.
Right.
And it just became flesh at that point. And that's what we always try to explain. Well, Jesus came here, and that's how he came here.
That's my point. Where do you mark the beginning? Jesus came, that's not the beginning. I think I probably would say that for some of you. That's not the beginning, that's the manifestation of the beginning. We must believe, then we have it. But most of us are trying to have it. When I say have it, I just mean because we are of this world, we want to see it, feel it, taste it, and touch it. Instead of believe it in spite of sense realm contradiction that contradicts the Word of God. We believe our senses, and we believe against the Word of God. And we do that, whether you recognize it or not, on a daily basis. Because we choose, we act contrary to the truth. Now that, that's not a point of condemnation. But I would do anything to shake one person, to go, man, that's, I don't want to do that. I want my life healed. And I want that reality so real that people can say, the Word is being manifested through you. The complete thought concept of God isn't you, but it's being manifested through you.
Okay. And when you do that, then you turn right around and pray away what God's trying to do. We try and pray those things away that God is spirit, that God is Jesus.
Absolutely. Because we're living. We don't like, we don't like certain things. But you know what it is? It's just your flesh that doesn't like that. Now you're making a choice if you want to go with your flesh. What do you want? You cannot stop your flesh from liking it. But you can go with your spirit and at least agree with God and say, I don't like it in my spirit. You've got to start somewhere, folks. You've got to start somewhere. Because God will not go against your will. If you don't line up with Him and come into agreement on some level, He's going to come down, slap that old flesh out of you. Folks, He ain't going to do that. He's not going to wrestle something that you're willing for out of your hand and out of the hands of the flesh, outward man. He will not do that. That will never happen. Never. You're waiting to walk into some service and God goes, da-da-da-da, or boom, or whatever. You're waiting for something really, really special to happen like that. And I'm going to tell you what it's going to be. One day, you're going to go, good grief, this is the truth, and I've got a spirit, and the first step I'm going to take is sin is sin, or flesh is flesh, and that which is flesh is flesh, and it can't produce anything but flesh. And my spirit is not for that, even if my flesh is for it. Just open the door for the Holy Spirit. There's still more to go. There's many steps that you must take. Glorious thing that you can do. But if you never do that, and here's why we never do it. Our flesh deceives us. We deceive ourselves. We say, well, if I enjoy it, then I must face it. That's the truth. That's the truth in the flesh realm, but that's not the truth. And then we say, and so then we void out our spirit and anything the Holy Spirit is trying to say to us and say, you hypocrite. How can you love that and say that you love me? You say, well, I'll tell you how. Because that's my flesh that loves that, but I love God and I ain't for that, and that's why the cross came, and I'm going to get over here to Jesus, and we're going to see an end to this. But you just, I must not love God. You walk down that with you. If you disagree with God, you agree with your flesh. Guess what? All the wine in the world will not bring the living. Going to be an act of faith. One day, sometime, maybe like 50 years, 5, mean, there's stuff, you know, sin is sin. You know, I mean, if I had an alcohol problem, I'd say, I sure like the taste of that. I'd say, my taste buds like the taste of that. But drinking is, to get drunk is sin. And God says, don't, you know, I don't drink and go, man, I'm sure life is. I'm a little bit, of course your taste buds like it. I mean, certain drinks will taste right. It's not a sin for your taste buds to go, ooh, yummy. That's not the sin. Don't you see? Do you see what I'm saying? The flesh likes those things. But you don't have to agree with the flesh that it's okay because I like it, or I'm totally sold out to it because my flesh likes it. Come, your spirit says, hey, what God calls sin, I call sin. And that doesn't mean that I don't call taste buds sin. You see, I got lots of things. I don't ever move the
shower. The thing that we were talking about the showers again, you know, you did mention before that if you're in a situation where you have to take cold showers, your flesh, obviously, is more than likely not going to like that. But that doesn't mean it has to rule, you know.
Right.
And that's the difference. Going with your spirit saying, hey, my spirit is in charge here, not my flesh, even though my flesh doesn't like it.
Right.
You know, and it's the simple choosing of who you represent.
See, what we want to do is jump in a cold shower and go, glory to God, glory to God, glory to God. That ain't even realistic. We are three parts, and you're just this physical flesh does not like a freezing, coming unfazed, which makes it water with ice cold. We don't like ice cold showers. We don't. But you don't get in there and you know, sometimes you fake yourself out. You're not spiritual. You're faking yourself out. Oh, glory to God. He never said it like that. He said, my flesh doesn't like this, but I'm not going to walk around going, oh, God, man, I hate this. And you people, why don't you get a little cash and get a little, you know, man, I'll tell you what. You know what I mean? Your physical flesh is not the problem. It's your fallen flesh that is demanding that this flesh be prepared. But if you get in there and you say, with your cold, cold showers in Jamaica, I never liked it. But I tell you what, I never complained. And I said, thank you, Lord, I get a shower. You know what I mean? I mean, if you ever, it's all relevant. Did you know that? A nice freezing cold shower can be a wonderful thing if you have a shower. You know what I'm saying? You know, but the deal is that you've learned that whatever you do, if you're eating a good meal, you're not feeding your flesh. So that when you go over to somebody's house, let's go take a better dish. The last 15 meals I had were great. Now come over here and these people. That means that's not an act of flesh getting upset at that moment. That is a manifestation of a life of flesh. Anybody agree with me? It really is. And so in almost everything you're doing, you're feeding the flesh. Or you're going out of spirit. It's hot in here. This is not comfortable. But you know what? I mean, I do know the second part. I believe that all things work together for good. God probably knew that I needed to sweat off some pounds, and sit here a couple of classes in a row and go up pretty soon, clean out them floors. Most Americans have never cleaned out their floors. They're all stuffed up. No one's going to die every kind of thing. You know what I mean? God gave you sweat glands and tear ducts. You're crying everything. That's fine. Cry it out. Nothing wrong with that. But go by the Spirit, ultimately walk by faith. said, man, he should have gone over here with the Lennox man. And while, you know, see, I believe God's going to give us everything we need at the right time and when we need it. I've read the day this place is beautiful. People start coming on here. You know what I mean? And they start going, whoa, glory to God, I mean, it's what a beautiful place. We're trying to talk to them about the cross. And they're going, yeah, everything they do should be. I mean, at least some of the stuff we have here exposes that you do have to watch. You know, the Garden of Eden's kind of hard to complain when there ain't nothing. I mean, there was only one thing in there, one out of everything in there, and it went right to it.
Place themselves on stage, they convince themselves on stage, they're speaking things, they call it ministry. fight, and no matter what it takes, you know, that we're going to miss the war. And we've been in some of the funniest times in the world. I mean, they directly complain that they haven't sleep before in the living room. You know, and it's like, ridiculous.
See, I don't understand that, because flesh is flesh. Jesus said that this is flesh is flesh. And, you know, I made a decision years ago that I wanted Jesus, and I wanted to know Jesus. Right? So here I go, I'm in Bible school, and it's not the best Bible school around and whatever, but I believe it's the place that I can learn Jesus. So I went there. And, you know, there was, you know, we, the men's dorm was like this big old thing. We ended up running into each other. We had like 300 students all together, so that, yeah. And all this, you know, and there was lots of conflicts, whatever, and when my flesh conflicted with something, and in a couple of cases it got to a conflict, my flesh, a situation where it looked like either my flesh better change, or I'm not going to be able to stay there and follow the Lord. I said, God, you got to change my flesh to get along with all. I want to know. Okay. That kept on. So then the situation went where I was at the mission. That I was wanting to follow and wanting to know the Lord. I wasn't trying to be a mission. Then I came back, that organization closed. There was only one organization. It was the worst, the one my flesh did not want to go to. But I wanted to know the Lord. I went there. It didn't matter. Then I just, you know, my flesh just has to get over anything. Because I will not feed it. I don't want to promote it. I don't want to pamper it anyway. Because every time I do, I'm compromising something that's going to make me eventually, if you compromise me, you just keep compromising. You will. You just keep compromising, you know. We just didn't listen to those bands and say, well, that's ridiculous. I can't do that. That's ridiculous. And yet, we do that in a world, you know, we make decisions, not, you know, primarily the number one decision. I want to know the Lord. I want to follow the Lord. That's it. You make that decision, you know what? It don't matter where you work. It don't matter where you go to church, if the Lord's going to teach you there, that's what's going to happen. It don't matter anything. Nothing else matters. All that matters is the Lord. And you spend the rest of your life pursuing that. Okay, I've got five roads. Which one leads the best to the Lord? And almost every time, that road that leads the best to the Lord is going to be a road of sacrifice. It's going to cost your flesh. But big deal. You're cutting off, you know, you're feeling back more flesh, your outward man is perishing daily, but your inward man is being redeemed. And the more you lose that outward flesh, the less that stuff is even going to be a factor. You won't even notice it as much. It wasn't a fun somebody in the church, somebody the other day. And he said, he used to, when he first came here and worked in the office, he turned on the air conditioner over there. And he hadn't been using it lately. I said, why not? He said, man, it's not good for you. Man, he says, you know, I'm just used to not having it. But our flesh gets used to having certain things. And we don't even realize that we're feeding our flesh. And so I find that now, to me, if you can have air conditioning, that's fine. But don't feed your flesh. There's a day out of those in this place there, which I would have 1 hour of a problem, not one. I don't want it to feed people's flesh. Don't you know that you can enjoy something in the Lord? You know, this is a thing that we forget. That God made us on this earth, and He gave us this earth to enjoy. We take about 3/4 of it and give it to the devil. We do. The devil convinces us that 99% of this is. There's a difference between the earth and the world system. You know? And he gives us all kind of clothes and stuff. I like a particular kind of clothes. It's what I like. But I don't feed my flesh with it. If somebody came along or some situation arose with the Lord of God that I had to change that and start wearing cowboy boots and westward, I would do it in a minute without hesitation. No matter the thing. Because Jesus is flesh. It's not my flesh preference. But if He gave me this world to enjoy and it doesn't contradict the cross, it doesn't contradict the cross, then I'll enjoy what I enjoy. He gave it to the earth as the Lord, so the world is thereof. You know? certain music. I like certain music. You know, as long as it ain't pumping the devil into me, some people it does. Or some people, you know, I've been listening to a lot. I've got about 3 or 4 days of Latin music. I really have been enjoying a lot of Spanish guitar playing. Just, you know, several times, all of a sudden. I just love to listen. Well, you know, I hadn't had a revelation of Christ yet. That's
but it's not heading to the Word.
You say, well, you could be sitting there pumping in the Word of God and whatever. And then my heart never leaves. And it comes up. I wake up. There. You know, God knows where my heart is. He knows where your heart is. He knows where our heart is. And where your heart is, that's where your treasure is. But, don't think that you're going to become so spiritual that you're spiritual by one or two things, either by going, oh, bless God, I would never use air conditioning. That's not the Lord. That is not the Lord to say it like that. That is not the Lord. Oh, bless God, I would never do that. Oh, bless God, I would never do this without whatever. That's not the Lord. This is the Lord. This is the reality. And He put us on this earth. And you know what? If I stood out there and a good breeze came up and started blowing over that property, you know what I would do? I'll tell you exactly what I would do. I would turn toward it, and I would lean back, and I would bend. I would draw up that feet. But I don't know about feelings, and I don't know if I get that breeze blowing over me when I walk out here. Oh, my God, where are you, Lord? Jesus is my life. Nothing's changed. You know? My Lord, dude, why'd you send these funky clothes out today? Everything else is dirty. Well, why don't you feed my flesh and get up at 3 o'clock in the morning and do what I want? You know, a whole lot of husband and wife arguments, a whole lot of junk goes on between me, but that's the flesh fighting for junk. Really? Well, okay, let's talk about relations and stuff that goes on the property here.
Flesh
wants flesh quiet, so flesh, brother flesh fights with sister. Flesh in a place like this and then say, okay, you know, I don't really want to act out all the time over this thing, so I've got to come up with a doctor to help me do it. Bless God, I'm laying down my life. You know what I mean? And I don't know what flesh is becoming spiritual, and the flesh is not spiritual. The flesh is flesh. That which is flesh is flesh. And this is spiritual. This up here, which doesn't even relate to how you're, you know, pores are feeling at this moment. You know? So then, you gloried in that so long, and then somebody comes over here and puts air conditioning in this place, you've got to change your doctrine. No, that shouldn't be the case. It's the truth, it's the truth, it's the truth. That shouldn't change. Do we keep going to be with all this sleep and then dropping this down on this overwhelming. But that shouldn't change. So now we've got air conditioning, so now we have to change our doctrine because my God, I can't be spiritual anymore, so we have to go, well, you know, that's the Lord blessing me for so many years. Yes. And that's a lot better than you because I have an air conditioning that came for years of suffering. But if you realize, here you are, you're here, this is it, this is your relationship. Whatever happens to my flesh, don't matter. You know, we're so, because if something good happens, we get all into it. You know, we start thinking now, if it's bad, I shouldn't go by that. But we go by everything that's good inside. You know what I mean? We're still going by the flesh. I'm here, I'm not of this world, I'm here in Christ.
Resurrection and his life, you will see that he will begin to live in those areas that you
really work. It's not finished the way it was in. The word was made flesh and manifested among us. For the word to manifest is not to bring it into existence. Right? Just because it manifested didn't make the word always was. But now it manifests down here, and it's all there. It is. Thank God, now it's real. Not always was true. So I wrote the word for the word to manifest is not to bring it into existence, but to make evident to the senses that which always was. It was made evident to the senses. And let me tell you this. God can make evident himself to your senses, and that can, your response to that can be, not necessarily, but it can be, if that feeds your senses. And now God must always feed your senses. For you to believe this. Sure. You don't have to be that way, but I mean, now you have to. You know, I believe we rob God many times. You know, people say, why didn't God manifest more, you know, through signs, wonders, and miracles? Why are you doing minor things and whatever? Why, you know, why is this going on? Well, one little sideline of that, I believe, is that God wants to. I think he likes to bless him and do his stuff, and you don't help it. Jesus walked the earth, he did fine. I think it's just the way he is. He's a giver, Well, why didn't he do more? You know, there's probably many different reasons. I'm telling you one little side. I think that he knows that for some of us, we're just going to run the back, get off the real path. Now, I think there's more to it than that. What? Absolutely, a lot more. And I said that's just a little side. I didn't even say that's the big reason. I just think it's a little side. There's a lot of angles that don't even match this. I think one of them is that most of the big stuff God did, he didn't do inside the church. He did it out there on the streets. That's my belief. I believe that. I believe that we're all sitting around waiting for miracles. And we see some of the biggest miracles when we go to Marco, we go out here, we see all this stuff. I believe when the church quits trying to feed itself and get fat and stuff, it's just pouring out there, we're going to see it real well. That's just one. I think there's so many different sides to this, we should never just assume anything. Okay, so, and I like this phrase, so maybe you want to jot it down. For the word to manifest is not to bring it into existence, but to make evident to the senses that which always was. Make evident to the senses. That's all manifestation is. Many deny the truth because the truth to them has its basis in sensual manifestation. The truth to them has its basis in sensual manifestation. So they deny it is true. To them, anything of faith is a lie. Because they don't see it, feel it, taste it, touch it. They say, just say that, I would be hypocritical. I would be lying, because that's not the truth. They're only talking about it in the sense realm. But it is the truth that always was, that always will be, and that we'll find when this whole backdrop of the world and universe is rolled up like a curtain, and we see the truth that has always been the truth, and go, oh my God, you know? He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And for those of us who have loved his appearing, as pastors, who are seeing this reality, to them he will appear the second time without seeing. And you will rejoice with him. You will rejoice in saying, well, of course you will, because, it even says it here, but let me read this to you again, verse 14, to show you. The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. See, he didn't say, this guy that dwelt among us, we saw. He said, the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. You see what I'm saying? And we beheld his glory. He didn't say the glory of his miracle worker. his prophet. The glory of the Word, we need held in for the glory of the only begotten of the Father. See this relationship? The glory of it. The reality of it. We saw him, and we beheld the glory of his name. Now, that means he plugged into 50. He didn't just see Jesus walking through the mirror and go, wow, he was really neat. He did some neat things in the flesh. He manifests real well. He said, we saw that which was from the beginning. That's what it says over there in 1 John. That which was from the beginning, we have seen, touched, and handled, for it was manifest among us. That which was from the beginning, we have seen, because he was made flesh. The Word, which was in the beginning was the Word, was made manifest, but he didn't see the manifestation. He saw through it to the reality. You know, life is an enigma. If you only see manifestation, you must learn to see from where it comes. You know, we go, well, I don't understand this, and then we get confused with everything, you know? And people misread Jesus. And if you see the source from where it came, then you understand the manifestation. You know, it's like we plant a seed, we don't understand, we don't know what seed. And while it's growing, we're hoping for apples. Then it turns out to be a peach tree. When the fruit comes out, we go, oh, those things. Well, you have to understand the source. You have to understand what you put in the ground and give away. That's where you're here, right? You can do this. Hell is a glory. What is his glory? Glory as of the only begotten of God. That's it, right here. You're in. You're in that. You're secure. Everything he says of Jesus is true of you. So why would you strive outside of Jesus to be something that he is not who you are? Why not strive to be a vessel of a treasure? Or to be a branch of the vine? Or to be, you understand what I'm saying? Why would you strive to be something apart from him? Any kind of stature apart from him. When he says, we have this treasure in earthen vessels so that there won't be any power of you, but the essence of the power of your God. So that another place he says, God has chosen foolish things and things that can't do it, don't have it together, so that no flesh of glory in his presence. So that when it's all done, you're discovered. When I plugged into this, everything that happened manifested was the same one that manifested 2,000 years before I came here, and all he did was manifest through me. I'm foolish, I'm not noble, I'm not wise, it's Jesus. And that's what it says. That God had chosen the foolish things of the world to confound, not the sinners, the yucky, the wise. And he says why he literally explains to the Father, so that no flesh. No flesh is the goal. Not little flesh, no flesh. Because if there's no little flesh, it will glory. So the cross took care of all flesh. That's why the cross, Christ has been crucified, is our home. If you think it's just a linear Holy Spirit demon that's going to be rid of your flesh, you're wrong. The Holy Spirit is dealing linearly with each of the cross that once and for all did away with the flesh you're receiving that alone. The linear dealing is simply the way to do that which already was. But the linear dealing is not bringing something about, it's manifesting what always was. But we get caught up in the linear dealing. Oh, I feel good. God's dealing with me right now. You know, God's dealing with me. So then he was dealing with you on that, and you forget what the dealing was. Freak out because you want to be dealt with. You never grow. You're just waiting for the next deal, the movement of God. Oh, thank God, you know, now he's dealing with me about this, you know. 6 months later, a year later, you're wandering in the wilderness, you pass that same spot again, and you get the same dealing. But you rejoice because, praise the Lord, you're still dealing with him. There's always that fear. He's going to quit dealing with you. I tell you, that's all there. He's going to quit dealing. I'm going to be separated. I'm not going to make them. No, all that's a linear concept. You cannot be separated in here. What shall separate from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus? Nothing. Either high, yeah, principality, the time, things present, things come. Oh, well, yeah, I mean, he's putting those in me thus far, but things come. I don't know what can come. I don't know what I'm capable of. And your relationship, they start. How good you're doing. If you get in here, you're secure. Don't ever leave it, but just hold it by faith. Just hold it and be there and just acknowledge the word. That's all faith is. The word is truth. Faith coming by hearing, hearing by the word. Word is by the living. That's the way it is. I'm accepted. Well, what did you do today that showed you acceptance? Well, not a darn thing. Well, how about today? Well, you know, I did this and that, and I ministered this person, I did that, but you know, I never hold one hour of that up to the Lord as a point of acceptance. In fact, I know that I'm here over here. That was just Him manifesting, Him blessing again, Him helping, Him pouring out His strength when I was in weakness, His ability, His love, His power. I'm just here. He just shooting from me. The Holy Man, no flesh, ain't gonna be no flesh in me glory about anything. Because it wasn't me. I mean, there's one step worse than working in your flesh to be something. And that is Him working through you to call for you. God is your life. He works through you. Jesus is your life, and He works through you. Don't you be grabbing the glory of God and taking the anointing or the nature as if you ought to be honored or there's something special about you down here. Don't do it. You know, isn't that the dealing that we were sharing with at the beginning of the New Year's Eve thing? Well, why would He share that? Because it's a possibility some may be doing it. He's trying to work towards the end of the year, but that might be a deal. You understand that? So man, don't touch your, don't put your hands. And you remember, there's several examples. One was the ark ship. Don't touch it, man. That's God. He can handle it. He can take care of himself. One is that Uzziah, King Uzziah, went in and decided he was going to put his hand to being a priest. And God says, that's not your area of authority. Don't you put your hand to it. Saul tried the same thing, tried to offer sacrifices and stepped out of his realm and claimed something for himself that wasn't his. Don't put your hand. Don't claim. Don't say, I say this a lot. If the angel said to Mary, call that thing that comes out of you Jesus. Don't call it Christianity. Don't call it the blessing of God. Don't call it my ministry. Call it Jesus. That was Jesus. Glory to God! Glory to God! Not, and I want to be, that was me just yielding to God. I'm so special. But God, I feel so good. You know, I know God. I know I'm in good with God now because this week's been a good week. Beware anytime you hear yourself say something. I mean, in the next thing you can come up and say, it's been a good week at work. But I mean, that's not what I'm talking about. It's been a good week. I know I'm really with the Lord. And in fact, there might be a chance you are blessed with the Lord. No, He worked through you by grace. You are actually blessed with the Lord. And at times when He's not, you're looking to Him and hoping, trusting. With arms out, rich needed. But in reality, what you do is you identify here, you hid in Christ, you found in Christ, and we talked about that last semester. You're both hid and found in Christ. And those two, that two-edged sword, the two sides of that begin to work in you. And then you don't ever, you see, that's the way to keep from taking glory to yourself. If you're identified up here, you're not identified on the linear line. Anything linear happens. Glory to God, glory to God. God is manifesting because I'm abiding here. You say, look, if you continue in me, if you abide in me, you shall. shall bear much fruit.
Then it's like a great big
pullback coming at you with pullback. You ain't gonna be able to tackle it initially by my little, you know, encouragement there and pulling them down. You gotta start somewhere. And if you don't, and if you're not actively working towards this goal, and you're waiting for God to zap you or knock you over the head or slap your flesh down till it's whimpering in your corner, it probably ain't gonna happen. There was a day, see, there's a time in our walk when we do that. There was a time when the church got to do that. Why are you doing that as much? Well, maybe some of you never read the book of Revelation of Christ, but I believe I saw the answer. Back in 1974, I think, when I wrote that book, and that is that everything that is true on a spiritual ground will manifest, and that we are in the time of the dealing of God, that it is no longer like that. It is a time of revelation where He wants to deal with us as sons. I believe it. Not something new I'm teaching. I've been in that book for 20 years. I do not believe He wants to mess with your flesh. He already messed with your flesh on the cross. He wants you to acknowledge it and stand up.